You are listening to the Redemption Church podcast with Pastor Daniel Williams as we go through the book of Daniel. We hope you are encouraged and blessed by this message.
If you do have a Bible that we gave you, it's page 742, what we're going to be looking at today, Daniel chapter 7. We love studying the Bible, and this book is called Daniel, and we've gone over six chapters so far. Six chapters, we're halfway there. Good job, team. Whoop, whoop. I don't know if you like progress, but I love that. I love that you could look at numbers and be like, hey, one, two, three, four, and everything just adds up. It's nice. So we're going to try to look at a whole chapter again today, and we're transitioning in this book of Daniel. We're having this theme of an everlasting kingdom, okay? And so the overarching theme of Daniel, the first six chapters, was what does it look like to live for God in a society that is not living for God? Daniel was taken captive as an Israelite, and under the Babylonian kingdom, had these pagan kings that were in charge of all the stuff that was against his religion, against his ways, but he still lived for God in that, being humble, serving God, and doing that. And we're in an important break in this book. Last week, we looked at more than a lion's den, Daniel and the lion's den, chapter six, and it was a sort of a timetable of his life. Now we're going to be going into more of the prophetic and future visions and dreams that Daniel had. And we're going to notice right away that this doesn't line up year by year. It's going to line up vision by dream, by vision and events and those type of things. And so the focus is now not going to be on what does it look like to live for God in a society, but what will God's kingdom actually look like when he establishes his physical rule and reign. And why I say prophetic is because Daniel is going to talk a lot of stuff that are things of the future, specifically things that he had no idea what was going to happen. Many times we'd have these visions or dreams, and he would just feel sick. He wouldn't understand how to interpret that or what it even looked like. We know now, looking back at it, we read it, and we're like, wow, God, you are amazing. This is like just history. One commentator said, prophecy is written history before it happens. And Daniel is just going to be writing this stuff, and then all of a sudden, it's like, wow, that happened, that happened, that happened. But there are some things that Daniel's going to see in visions and dreams about the end of days, the end of time, the end of mankind that hasn't happened yet, because clearly you all are here sitting to me, talking to me, right? Okay? What we like to know and we're interested in is a big word called eschatology, the study of end times. And people are really fascinated with this subject. You even get people spending millions and millions of dollars on movies like this. The world is going to end. Oh, look, someone's going to save the world. It's saved. That was a great movie. Apocalyptics. Even we were talking in prayer this morning, like, yeah, the last X-Men movie was called what? Apocalypse, right? And so people are fascinated and like, they have all these ideas about, is the world going to end? What does that look like? And they get all these different ideas about eschatology, the study of end times, when Jesus will come back again and rule and reign physically through movies, through opinions, through just sort of like, I think that'd be cool, just sort of like how Wolverine has metal in his arms. That'd be awesome. And so what we want to do as a church is look to what God's word says, because he does talk about these things. He does say how things will take place. And prophecy is one where it's always supposed to spur us on in our faith and point us to Jesus. Isaiah chapter 46, 8 through 11, God actually tells through the prophet Isaiah, the reason why he gives prophecy is so that we would know that he is God. That he can declare the things that don't even happen. And when they do happen, you could be like, oh yeah, that's because he's God. Because he's sovereign, he's Lord. He knows what's going to take place in the future. And so application of prophecy really is for us to be in awe of God, to see how much power he is, and to help us right now to live for him, to live for his kingdom. And so we're going to get into this part, this section of really the end times, talking about prophecy and what's that to look like, and maybe it could be this, and maybe it could be that. And here's what I found out with Christians. Christians love the study of end times. Like, there are some Christians, Pastor, when are we going to get deep? When are we going to get deep? They could study the book of Revelation, okay, for like 3.5 years, all right? And they'd be like, oh, but we just scratched the surface. We're not going to do that. We're still going to try to take a chapter. Now, today was Story Sunday. I didn't have enough time to even put together a story because I was so in depth and there's so much stuff. But I want us to realize, what in the world is the point of prophecy? It's not just to have a whole bunch of heady information. It's scripture we're always looking at, prophetic word. And with scripture, what did Jesus say? Scripture points us to himself. So yes, we do have ideas and we do have some details and we're going to talk about stuff. But people can get so wrapped up and lost in this details, they forget the whole point. Like, for example, no one knows the time or the hour that God will come back. Matthew 24 talks about that. Jesus said that, right? We all know that. But we're so focused and so stimulated by just these details and conspiracy theories, right? And it's almost like a due date. Like, we have a due, when you're pregnant, like Itzy is pregnant right now. She's going to be due sometime in December. When's your due date? January. Oh, January. Okay, wow. I thought it was December. I was totally off. So she's pregnant. The doctor gives her a due date. And we could spend, now, if we wanted to, hours upon hours making a poll and being like, I think it's going to be before January, December 20th. Well, I think it's going to be January 2nd on 2 p.m., 2:20 p.m., 22nd. And people spend so much time and energy forgetting the main point of why you have a due date. A baby is coming. You know that, right? Every night now, you're like, I can't sleep. No, here's the whole point. Here's the purpose of all this stuff. Yes, we can have some detail. We can have an idea. It's not so vague where we're like, well, no one really knows. Let's not even study. It's not even worth it. No, it's actually good to study the Bible. It's good to study prophetic word. It's fine to have an interpretation. But don't miss the point. The baby is coming. Be ready. When you get a baby, there's the Bible talks about, Jesus said that there's going to be these signs that we can look for. They're like birthing pains. And all of a sudden, the baby's going to come. And it's the joy of the baby that we get to have. It's the joy of the second coming that we get to be with Jesus forever, face to face for all eternity. And so let's not get so wrapped up sometimes in the details. Peter says this in 2 Peter 1:19, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and morning star rises in your hearts. Peter says it's good for us to pay attention to the prophetic word of God. It's like light in a dark place. It's gonna help us to see and to picture and to illuminate and to focus on Jesus and how amazing and good he is. But if we're just calculating these conspiracy theories and dates and all this different stuff, what ends up happening is you forget, the Bible says when we look at prophecy, to be ready, to be ready. And so there are some in this room that have done a lot of study about this, biblical study, and it's amazing and they're excited. There are other people that they really have no idea right now even what I'm talking about, and this is a whole new subject. And so I'm in a very difficult spot to be like, how do I teach this? Where does it go? But that's like every week, right? And I trust that the Holy Spirit will teach what he needs to teach. But I do want to give you a reference and a framework of some things that you could study on your own. We put this on the resource table. I made this. This is 11 by 17, and this is still really small font, okay? This is how much scripture talks about it, and this isn't all the verses. But this is a biblical timeline of the end of time, time events, okay? And I want you to be aware that many Christians have different views of this subject. We hold a dispensational premillennialism eschatology view. Now, I know what you're thinking. I can't believe Daniel just said that big word like that. Wow, that was amazing, incredible. Yes, dispensational premillennialism eschatology view. Yes, most of you are actually thinking, what in the world is he talking about? I don't necessarily bring a lot of big words like that. I know some Greek, things like that, and I study in concordance. I don't do that. I want to make sure that we're teaching in such a way it's simple. But I also want you to be aware of sort of the mind frame and the backdrop of what we believe as a church, as pastors, as things as we study that we're not going to be able to get into all right now. But even later on the sermon, I'm just going to have a glossy of sort of words like the Battle of Armageddon. You know, it's actually in the Bible. It's not just a movie. Wah, wah, wah. Pretty awesome, okay? There are things like that. And Daniel is like a foundation of the end times, of the end of the world, but the Revelation really gives more detail. So I'm going to have to give a lot of reference, a lot of these things. But I sort of want you to know sort of the position or what I think and how I interpret and we as a church interpret through Scripture these things. And many godly people interpret it different ways. But this is sort of where we see dispensational time and events and of a premillennialism, which basically is meaning we emphasize a thousand-year reign, an actual, literal thousand-year reign of Christ. And so what we see is God working in Israel and Jesus coming, being the Messiah and Savior, dying on the cross, okay? Then there's the work through the church. And as God and his Holy Spirit is in us and working through this church age, society will grow evil. It will grow worse and worse and worse. Then we believe that the rapture will happen. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 talks about how we will be caught up. Rapture, if you search in your Bible, is actually not in the Bible. It's a Latin word, raptuos, okay? And so it's just giving mind frame and set and language to something that the Bible teaches. Then there will be this great tribulation, seven-year tribulation, where the Antichrist, a great world leader, will rule, and he will bring forth peace with the economic system in such a way where people will actually follow this person. And we're going to talk about the Antichrist today and what Daniel had in his vision of who he is and all those different things. Well, after 3.5 years, it's going to go pretty nuts and pretty chaotic. There's going to be abomination of desolation where this Antichrist is going into the temple of Israel and will sacrifice and basically declare that he is God. And the great tribulation, the wrath of God will be poured out upon mankind. Jesus said when this happens, this great abomination of desolation in Matthew chapter 24, 25, don't even worry about your stuff. Run for the hill. The wrath of God is going to be poured out. And then the second coming of Christ. And he will come with his bride in the great battle of Armageddon and actually attack the Antichrist, the world leaders, and he will have victory with the word of his mouth. And he will rule and reign for 1,000 years. And then there will be the final judgment and eternity. Did you know that was all in there? That's just a little theology, little end times thing. But there are also other views. Now, this isn't just something where it's like, wow, that looks like, that was just like a Left Behind video. No, there are actually many scholars and people that have studied the word to get this sort of position, okay? And so you have commentaries, old school, like Ironside, Ironside, the founder of Calvary Chapel, which we're affiliated with, Chuck Smith. But you also have contemporaries, great Bible scholars that hold to this position, like John MacArthur. You also have, I know Ronnie listens to Charles Stanley, other people in right now that view this, that would say, hey, they're a, boom, this idea. But there are other positions as well, and I want you to be aware of them, and I want you to sort of have this backdrop and know. All millennialism. Now, everyone agrees about the cross of Christ and eternity, okay? But all millennialism is basically this mindset where we're in the millennial kingdom right now. And the millennial isn't a literal thousand year, it's actually just a symbol. And tribulation actually happens during the church age and then the second coming. And you may think, well, really? That's like a well thought view? Yes, it is. People like Luther, Martin Luther, or John Calvin hold to this view. Contemporary scholars would hold to this view would be like a J.I. Packer. And if you don't know who these people are, that's fine. These are just things that I'm aware of and I know and I study, all right? There's also the postmillennialism view where they talk about the cross of Christ, but then there is this church age. And basically, they believe that society is going to get better, that God's people in his church are going to bring the kingdom in and usher the kingdom in with good works, that the kingdom really, Jesus won't literally rule and reign physically, but through his church, they'll go through tribulation. And you may say, well, I've never heard that view. Well, a guy named Charles Spurgeon had this view, a well-respected evangelist. A contemporary would be a guy like J.C. Sproul. What's my point to all of this? Because sometimes when people talk about these end times and this eschatology, you have to understand people have a lot of different views and in different interpretations of what Scripture says. And so I'm going to be teaching with the backdrop and the best that I can of what I believe that God is speaking and saying. But I also want to understand and make sure you know that there are many people that love Jesus that all believe in the same exact thing, that Jesus is the Messiah, that he died on the cross for our sins, and we will be with him for all eternity because of his grace. And some of these details we could sometimes argue and fight, even amongst Christians. Now, you may have never seen this before, but did you know that Christians sometimes even fight? It's crazy. I mean, none of you, but just some people. And so what this subject, bringing this up, is not something to cause division. It's prophecy. It's scripture. We're trying to focus on Jesus. So our mission is still the same, pursuing and proclaiming Jesus. But I also want you to be aware that maybe if you have a different view, that's fine. But I want you to at least know my view and where I'm coming from scripturally of when I teach some of this stuff, what's going on. And honestly, some people have never even thought about this. Some people, I talk to them, they don't even care. I just want Jesus. Well, the thing is, we're going through scripture and Jesus talks about it. And he's giving visions and dreams to Daniel. And so we just want to do our best to study scripture, to see what it has to say, and keep in mind the big picture. Jesus wins. We get the joy of Jesus. Everyone agrees that he's the Messiah and the King, that he's Lord. Everyone agrees that with a relationship with him, you could have eternal life. And you know what? It sometimes gets a little freaky when you start having conspiracy theories and end of the world, and is that person the Antichrist, and this person, and that, and all this other stuff. When really the Bible is not for us to focus on all these little minor things, it's actually to give us the big picture of who God is. And so we continue our study in Daniel, and we're going to look at Daniel chapter 7, and I'm calling this message Visions of Kingdoms, Visions of Kingdoms. Daniel is going to get visions from God about six different kingdoms in this chapter, very similar to Daniel chapter 2, which we've gone over. Remember when Nebuchadnezzar, the king of the Babylonian Empire, he had this great dream of a statue of gold, statue of silver with the arms, and then the bronze, and then the iron legs with the iron toes and mixed clay. It's similar to that, but it's a different perspective. And rather than having a vision of this great statue, this thing that we esteem, these precious metals, Daniel's going to have somewhat of the same interpretation and the same visions and see the same thing, but from a different vantage point, from God's vantage point. And he's not going to see a great big statue in these precious metals. He's going to see beast. He's going to see how kings are really out for themselves and kingdoms are for themselves and man is sin and they're actually defying against God. And so he's going to be getting these fresh perspective on these kingdoms. And the first thing that we see is that God is in control. And so let's read verses 1-8. And look how God is in control. No matter what kingdom, no matter what thing happens, Daniel gets this perspective of things to come. And it helps him to realize, oh yeah, God's in control. Oh yeah, he is the King of Kings. He is sovereign. He is moving. His dominion will be an everlasting kingdom. I can trust God even now in the moment that I'm going through. So verse 1-8. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and visions in his head. So he had a dream and visions in his head as he lay down in bed. Then he wrote down the dream and told the sum of the matter. Now these visions become, there. If you want to sort of like time frame, they're actually in between chapters 4 and chapters 5 because we see this is the king, Belshazzar. And remember, he was introduced to us in chapter 5, okay? So this is actually the time frame of when Daniel, after King Nebuchadnezzar fell in chapter 4, and before we see him in chapter 5. Daniel declared in verse 2, I saw in my vision by night, behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. And then as I looked, its wings were plucked off and was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and the mind of a man was given it. And behold, another beast, a second one, like a bear. It was raised up on one side. It had 3 ribs in it, in its mouth, between its teeth, and it was told, arise, devour much flesh. After this I looked, and behold, another was like a leopard, with 4 wings of a bird on its back. And the beast had 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. Verse 7, after this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a 4 beast, terrifying and dreadful and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth. It devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feast. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had ten horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little one, before which three of the first horns were plucked up by the roots. And behold, in his horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Let's just pause right there and make sure we understand this. Don't you love that we read the Bible, but then we actually stop and study it? Have you ever even like, this has happened. People still have visions and dreams. And sometimes you could even have a vision from God, see something, and you're like, what was that? Are you kidding? What? A lion like a bear, but like a with wings? And what is this even saying? Well, we see in vision, Daniel sees these four great kingdoms and one satanic kingdom controlled by the Antichrist in there. And you may say, wow, what? Let's look at it. Because I think it's important as we study these last times, we get a little freaked out and we say, well, what's happening here? What does this mean? What's going on? Daniel is seeing these earthly kingdoms evolve and these beasts evolving. And you know what? This is no different than from us. We see kings come and go. We see presidents come and go. We see world leaders come and go. And we still ask the same question. What's happening? Like markets right now are crashing because Trump got elected. What's happening? What's the unforeseen future? People may not be, get even think grand big idea, but haven't you ever asked, what's going to happen next month? Am I going to pay my bill? Is God really in control? What's going to happen with my children? What's going to happen with my marriage? What's going to happen in life? And God is trying to reassure Daniel in the midst of him being in Babylon to be like, listen, I'm a God that's in control. I'm going to tell you and show you and give you visions so you know that I'm in control and I know what's happening. Honestly, I have no idea what's going to happen in the future. If I did, I would be a millionaire because I would just go to Vegas one time and say, Lord, forgive me, and then I would bet and it would be awesome. And I would totally tithe to the church. It'd be great. But don't you wish you knew the future, what was happening, what was going, because it would cause you, if you knew what was going to happen, it would cause you to be less stressful. You wouldn't worry about those things because you would know. If you knew that a bus was going to come and sideswipe you, you would just be like, I'll put on my brakes. I won't go for a drive that day. Problem solved. But we don't know what's happening. But we do know someone that does. God knows what's happening. God knows what's happening and what to do. And like we read in Psalm 146, in the beginning of our worship, we're to trust in God, not in princes, not in kings, not in presidents. We're to trust in God because he is the one that's in control. And God is the one that rises, that makes kings rise and makes kings fall. Look at verse 2 and 3. It says, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. There was these winds stirring up the sea, and four beasts came out of the sea, different from one another. There was this wind, the sea, the beast came out. Verse 17 of this chapter tells us that beast represents earthly kingdoms. It says that these four great beasts are four kings who shall arise out of the earth. So I love that. Sometimes people have all this speculation and stuff. It's like, well, you know, you could just go to the Bible to interpret the Bible. And a lot of these visions that Daniel has, there's actually interpretation like right there in the text. And so rather than being all confused, you can just say, oh, well, that's just like that passage. And that's like that passage. And oh, that was exactly what Jesus said. So let's just let him define that for us. So Daniel starts to see these winds and the heavens stirring up with great sea. Now, this is important because restless seas are frequent Bible imagery for nations of the world, right? You really can't control, like Isaiah 17:12, Isaiah 57:20, even Revelation 13. When we think of restless seas, they're nations of the world, and it says these seas are unpredictable, but the Lord stirs them to do his will. There's wind coming from heaven, and he's motioning the seas and getting these things in motion. And out of that heaven wind, out of that power, out of that dominion, we see these beasts coming up and these things rise. This should be nothing new to us because in Daniel chapter 4, verse 32, it says, the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. And so when you see this imagery, you have to say, well, what does other scripture say about this stuff? Well, it says the heavens of the wind, God's controlling things, and this wind, this unrelentless, this things that you can't control, God can. He can make a king fall and he can make a king go down. He could raise up a nation and he could take a nation down. I'm reading this personally right now in my devotions, just in 1 and 2 Kings, and man, I'm really disappointed about how many evil kings there were ruling Israel. It's really lame, but you know who knew about that? God. And he's like, well, prophet, go tell him. Oh, now you're going to anoint him. Nope, now your day is done. Even though these kings are evil and they're beginning this power for a time, God is orchestrating and doing this and giving them chances and proving his character over and over and over and over and over again. And he's doing this again in Daniel. And so this is a great timely reminder, especially us in our nation with new leadership, with uncertainty and how much division we have. Can we just say, well, God's in control? And as Christians, I mean, we could be disappointed or we could celebrate, but our hope is in nothing. I mean, our hope is in God, not man, not in a prince. Our hope is in the Lord. And so we need to make sure that we focus on that, that we're not so divided and so putting our hope in someone that right now is elected or someone that is not. And we need to continue to pray for our nation. Let's not forget the mandate of Christians is we're to pray for all leadership. It doesn't matter who gets elected, not just for our presidents, but for our senators, our governors, people that we disagree with. There should be from the Christian side a sense of power and of unity and love being displayed for all mankind. And so we don't have political, you know, ground. This is not a blue church or a red church. Okay, this is not about that. This is about making something so much greater, that realizing God is so much greater and he's the one in control. Now, Daniel goes on and is encouraged by this, I'm sure, because he's starting to understand. Remember, things like Isaiah were written before his time. He had these scriptures to interpret, okay? And he talks about these beasts. Now, these four earthly beasts, in verse 4, it says, the first one is Babylon. It's like a lion and an eagle's wings. And they ruled from 605 BC to 339 BC. And scripture actually identifies this kingdom both as a lion and an eagle. If you look at Isaiah, if you look at other things, when you talk about Babylon, man, it's one of those things where it's like a lion and eagle. Archaeologists, huge theological... Do you know how many letters are in premillennialism and all this different? And now I can't even say like normal words. Thank you. It's a life of a preacher, man. I'm just always in the heavenlies. It's amazing. It's beautiful. I love it. Archaeologists have actually found from the nation at that time, the emblem for that empire, the Babylonian Empire, was, you can guess, a lion and an eagle. This lion with wings. Wow. Now, I know what you're thinking. Well, that's not impressive. Daniel is probably got an insert. He was an Israelite, taken by this nation. He probably could have just made this up. He probably saw the statue and was like, oh, well, clearly. Well, then he also experienced Daniel chapter 4 when King Nebuchadnezzar had this dream and he got humbled. You remember that when we went through that Bible study? Well, this is what he said. In this vision, then I looked and its wings were plucked off. It's signifying the glory. They were plucked off and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man. The mind of a man was given to it. And wings got plucked off, representing God humbling this king. Daniel chapter 4, we studied that and looked at that. And you may say, well, okay, he saw a vision, could have made it up. That was awesome. But for earthly kings, there's more kingdoms. There's more kingdoms to come. The second earthly kingdom is the Medo-Persian Empire, which again correlates to the statue that Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 2 saw. They ruled from 539 BC to 331 BC. Now we see specifically this prophecy actually be fulfilled, okay, in Daniel chapter 5, when Belshazzar the king was defeated. Now, when this prophecy came out in Daniel chapter 2, everyone would have laughed at Daniel because we already talked about how, I mean, ginormous the walls were in Babylon, how incredible this kingdom was. It was still one of the greatest monarchs ever to be known. But Belshazzar was prideful, was drunk with all of his official leaders, and guess what? This kingdom, like a bear, was raised up and devoured them. And it says, Daniel in verse 5, was raised up on one side. The Persian Empire was greater than the Medes, okay? They were a collaboration, a dynamic duo, but really we all know the Persians were stronger. And so this bear was strong. This bear devoured flesh, okay? And what it means by like bear, and if you look at history, the Medo-Persian Empire, how they did battle is if they got to you, you would die. It's over for you. Because they would actually go with like a city, like a state, and attack you. It would be average, they would have 2.5 million soldiers, history says, when they went. And they would take most of those people in the Medo-Persian Empire, when they would go to battle with 2.5 million soldiers, would also take their family and their children as well. So you're looking at a battleground in a field, soldiers coming attack your city of around 4, 5, 6 million people coming to you. And once they got to you, it was over. Just like a bear. He may not be as fast as a lion, but once he gets to you, it's ferocious. And do you know the three great battles that they won? Because there was three. Because this is prophecy, so it has to be true. See, they won Babylon, they won Egypt, and they won Lydia. Like this verse says, they had three ribs in their mouth in between its teeth. These are the three great victories and battles that this empire had. And Daniel saw that and lived through that. And you may think, wow, that is amazing. Because I'm sure at that time, no one believed Daniel. But verse 6 tells us another kingdom. As I look and behold another, like a leopard with wings. Now, a leopard, I was even watching a video on Facebook, like just watching a leopard run like 101 kilograms. Like they're really fast, okay? And the significance of wings are they're even faster. It's not just like a fast, it's like a fast, fast animal with four wings of a bird in its back. And the beast had four heads and dominion was given over it. This is the third empire that Daniel wasn't alive in. It was from 331 BC to 150 BC, which we actually know because we get a lot of our culture from the Greece empire, where a little guy named Alexander the Great, you ever heard of him? See, we know him because, you know, we've actually watched movies, and it's awesome. And we're like, oh, that's Alexander the Great. This is incredible. This is amazing, man. Yeah, it was amazing. He conquered the known world in 12 years. It was super, super fast. And you know, he beat the Medo Persian Empire. You know how he did it? Short and quick. They had their 2.5 million soldiers. He only had 35,000. And so they never knew where he was attacking. So they would go, boom. That side, come out, boom, that side, that. And it was just like prancing on people, and he actually infused. And it's told that Alexander the Great got so depressed because he conquered the world so quickly. I mean, think about accomplishments. He accomplished it so quickly, he was depressed. It's like, well, now what am I supposed to do? Because he was a visionary. He was a leader. He was this great tact, like this amazing military person. And actually what ended up happening is he got so bored, so out of his mind, so depressed that he had the whole world, he just ended up getting drunk a lot, just doing whatever he wanted to do. Got so drunk one time, didn't want his servants to follow him, and it was raining. He got a cold, fell into pneumonia, and died. It was so quick, he didn't have a predecessor. You know how usually you should have like a vice president or a predecessor, something? Well, he's the known living king of the entire world, and it happened so quick, there was no predecessor. So you know who took over his empire? Four generals. Just like the Bible says here, it says the beast had four heads. He had four generals that had to split his kingdom because one, he was so young, and it was so quick. When he died unexpectedly, the four beasts of the four heads, the generals split the power. Now we look at verse 7. We see this fourth earthly kingdom, Rome, 150 BC to 476 BC. And we covered a lot of this stuff and other details that I gave you in Daniel chapter 2. But man, isn't it just fun and exciting to be like, whoa, God said this and it happened that accurate? This is pretty amazing. After this, in verse 7, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, terrifying and dreadful and exceedingly strong, and it had iron teeth. It devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feet. The Roman Empire conquered one nation at a time, like an iron fist, and they would just devour it, just chew it slowly. They would go after one nation and then take it in one nation. Empire, the Greece Empire, Alexander the Great, had like already built a lot of the roads. We know that like the phrase, all of the roads lead to Rome. Well, that was actually Alexander the Great that started that. He wanted the Greek culture all over the world. That's why the primary language when Jesus was around was Greek. The Bible's written in Greek and Hebrew. And so Rome utilized that, built better roads and stuff, and they would just take out one city after the next, just chomping, chewing, ruling with an iron fist. And they were the most great, strongest empire. If you look at just the span of that, over 600 years, they were large, they were strong, they were most unified kingdom, and they ruled for a long time. And now you look at Daniel 2 and 7, and it seems like Daniel just copied history, doesn't it? It seems like, well, what? No, this is like we have history books, but yes, maybe he could have made up the first vision because of the lion and the wings, but could he have talked about Alexander the Great like this? Could he have talked about Rome like this? This crazy thing happened. Don't lose the fact and the amazing that what God says goes, and he's revealing this vision to Daniel so that we would know the proven character of God, because what does prophecy do? It shows us how amazing God is and how great he is. This shows us that God truly is in control and knows what's going to happen, even in our uncertainty, and we can trust him. But there's one other kingdom. Because if you remember, Daniel chapter 2, there was the legs of the Roman Empire. But then there was this like weird jump of like toes. Same idea. In verse 7 and 8, it talks about this. It goes on and talks about a demonic kingdom. And it says it was very different from all the other beasts. It was like the beast, but it was different from all the other beasts before it because it had 10 toes. Now I considered the toes, and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little one, before which three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, a mouth speaking great things. Now, the reason I say a demonic kingdom and these kings were led by a great ruler is because it's the same idea. The 10 horns should remind you and prompt you of what we already studied of the 10 toes mixed with iron and clay. And this is where I have a little glossy, and I'm going to fill in some details for you, not knowing that, I know that we don't have a lot of time and different things like that, but I think it's important to understand. So when we talk about the Antichrist and this toe that arises, you could read about the Antichrist. There's a lot of different verses on some of these words that I'm about to say. So like 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 through 12, or Revelation chapter 13, you could read about who this guy is. Now the horns represent, and in biblical terms in that time, power, authority, kings. When Rome would rule, there would be these power, these 10 powers, these 10 horns that would arise, and they would rule. And there would be this power struggle. This one little horn would arise out of those 10, and there would be a struggle, and they would take away three of those horns, and he would lead these horns, these powers, these kingdoms. But this hasn't happened yet. Remember, this beast is sort of different. This hasn't happened yet. And when we understand prophecy, we have to understand that prophecy is always around the nation of Israel. Well, we sort of have a weird problem because in 70 AD, Rome, the empire, got rid of the temple, got rid of Israel, destroyed it. The temple was destroyed. There was no more sacrifice. There was none of these things in place. And it's almost like there was a pause button on this prophecy. Because when we come to prophecy, we can figuratively and do all that stuff. But when God says he's going to do something, we sort of take it literally. And so if we're waiting for this fourth power to come and we identify as Rome, we're thinking, okay, when is that going to happen? That has to happen because it hasn't happened yet. Does that make sense? It has to be something in the future because it hasn't happened, but the Bible says it's going to happen. And the reason why it didn't happen is because Israel was destroyed and there was prophecy about Israel at this time as well. You could look at this. This is the most amazing thing to me, and it's incredible of how Israel was destroyed but prophesied to come back and be a nation again. This has never happened. This is like why we don't have Medes and Persians or these different empires that still exist, right? In Amos 9, 14 through 15, we have Zechariah 8, 7 and 8. A lot in Jeremiah 32, 37 and 8. It basically says that Israel will be destroyed and they will come back as a nation. This actually happened in our time, 1948. Israel became a sovereign nation again. And so this is why the heightened of prophecy and interpretation comes about because we're like, oh, it actually happened. It's almost like this Roman Empire now is, the pause button is off and resurrected, and the Roman Empire is being resurrected in a sense because we're looking still for this temple. We're still looking for these horns to come about. And of course, we have to fill in gaps of prophecy through revelation, and we get a lot of details, but we can actually go into Daniel. Remember Daniel chapter 2? And we talk about the statue and the iron with the toes and like, what, why would you think that's futuristic? Well, Daniel chapter 2, verse 44 says this, and in the days of those kings, speaking of the 10 toes, the ones that are lifted up, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that never shall be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left another people. That in that time, God is going to set up his eternal dominion, his second coming, that he will rule and reign for all eternity. And that hasn't happened yet. And so we look to that. Now, we don't know exactly when this is going to happen because when you read the New Testament, you start getting this idea that we're going to be caught up with the Lord, the rapture. This is found in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 and 18. And 1 Corinthians 15, it talks about how in a twinkling of an eye, there's going to be some people that don't die. We're going to be caught up and be with the Lord. And I believe that the rapture and the second coming are two distinctive events. Jesus talks about how because of this, we have this uncertainty that we are to be ready. Like birthing pains, we know the last days are going to come, but we have to be ready for that. We have to be ready for his return. And there are verses about the last days where people will say what is evil is good and what is good is evil, like in Matthew chapter 24. But listen what Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 4. This is a verse about the last days. Just listen to see if this sounds like something like our culture right now. But understand this, that in the last days, there will be times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Sounds a lot like our culture today. And I think sometimes we forget, sort of like the frog in a pot. You ever heard that illustration before? You know, if you put a frog in a pot and you start turning up the temperature, you don't even have to have a lid on it. It won't jump out because it just thinks it's normal. So it gets 1 degree hotter and 1 degree hotter and one until it just dies. And I'm telling you right now that people 50 years ago, okay, for Israel came a nation, if they would be going nuts even if they just saw normal television right now. They wouldn't even worry about the technology and how the mark of the beast can play in and all this stuff. Just from our culture and what we find to be acceptable and what society says is good is actually evil and evil is good, they would just go crazy and they would just start screaming and saying, guys, do you not understand? These are the last days. These prophecies are being fulfilled right before your eyes. How is everyone going to see, this and that? Well, you can see stuff all over the world now in your pocket. You could pay stuff with a fingerprint now. Some of these things in Revelation, you're like, oh, well, yeah, that totally makes sense. That's not a big deal. But it's because we're in it. We're in the midst of it. We're seeing Israel become a nation. We're seeing all this different stuff. And again, it's not to speculate. It's not to get us freaked out. But Jesus said, therefore, keep watch in Matthew 25, 13. Because you do not know the day or the hour, that there is nothing that needs to happen before the rapture comes and we're with the Lord. Because we can look at Scripture and clearly see. And no one disagrees that God, that Jesus is coming back, the second coming of Christ. Jesus said himself in John 16, 27, that there will be a physical reign, establishment of his kingdom, a great day of judgment, for the Son of Man is coming, is going to come to his Father's glory with his angels, and this will reward each person according to what he has done. There will be a time where everyone opposes God will be judged, and there will be rewards for those who follow him. Jesus will actually establish his kingdom, which we like to call as heaven. Some people think heaven, and the enemy has gotten in our minds that heaven's this boring this place. We're going to be on a cloud, and there's nothing to do. It's actually a culture. It's actually a physical king, and it's going to be amazing. Just like if you've ever been to a big city before, and there's like culture and arts and music and people and relationships and food and all this different stuff happening all the time, it's going to be so much better than that because it's a real thing, and no one argues with this. But yet, somehow in our culture, we forget because we're physical and we think, well, I don't know, dying and all this different stuff. Who could really know? Well, we should know. Timothy talks about, Paul told Timothy, we should study the scripture to give us self-approved. We should look at these things and recognize the day and the manner that we're in. And in the last day, there's going to be this great battle of the ten horns called the Battle of Armageddon. This resurrected Roman Empire is going to come up, and there's going to be economic instability. And so this one Antichrist is going to arise, and he's going to lead these 10 men, and he's going to sacrifice after 3.5 years, saying that he is God, demanding worship, and God is going to pour out his wrath upon the earth. And I don't think that we're going to be there. 1 Thessalonians says God has not appointed that we would get his wrath. Jesus took our wrath. There's things that the Bible says, but the reality is in one moment, in the Battle of Armageddon, Revelation 16:16, and they assembled at the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon, this demonic force, this kingdom, all these world powers would just be done by the word of how powerful Jesus is. And you could read about this. People are actually going to physically wage war against God himself. Revelation 19:20. Listen to the language, because remember how I said Daniel's a foundation, we get a little more details in Revelation? Listen to Revelation 17:12-14. And it talks about how Jesus is going to have victory in this great battle. Chapter 16, there's going to be a battle, and then 17, he's going to wipe them out, like, and 19, he's going to judge them, and, you know, hell. But listen to 17, verse 12 through 14. And the ten horns, have you ever heard of that before? It's right in Daniel. And the ten horns that you saw are ten kings. Same language, giving more detail, who have not received royal power, but they are to receive authority as kings for 1 hour, together with the beast. Remember this obscured, weird beast? People are like, oh, just beast, what is that language? Well, if we just go with what the Bible says, and in Daniel, the beast is a king and an empire, and this is a resurrected king with ten horns and this beast. These are of one mind, and they hand over their power and authority to the beast. They will make war against on the Lamb, and the Lamb will conquer them. For he is the Lord of lords and the King of kings, and those with him are called and chosen and faithful. The Bible clearly says things are real, and these are true, and we'll win. God is powerful over a demonic force, over any empire. How do we know all this stuff? Well, in this chapter, Daniel is pondering about this last kingdom, the Antichrist. Like, what? This doesn't make any sense. Now, jump in your Bible down to verse 19. Then I desired to know the truth about the fourth beast. This is what we're talking about, this fourth beast, which was different from all the rest, exceedingly terrifying in its teeth of iron and claws of bronze, and which devoured and broken to pieces and stamped that what was left in its feet. And about the ten horns that were on its head, and the other horn that came up, and before there three of them that fell, and the horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoken great things. Other translations say pompous things. It's blaspheming things. He's a very wise, crafty person, and he's going to be very wise and crafty, like 2 Thessalonians tells us. And that greater, they seem greater than its companions. Verse 21, as I looked, this horn made war with the saints and prevailed over them, until the Ancient of Days came, speaking of God, and judgment was given for the saints of the Most High, and the time came when the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus he said, as for the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom of the earth, which shall be different from all the other kingdoms. It shall devour the whole earth and trample it down and break it to pieces. As for the ten horns, out of this kingdom, ten kings shall arise. Remember when I talked about how Scripture should interpret Scripture? This is Daniel pondering, and then God's giving him the interpretation. These kings shall arise, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be different from the former ones, and shall put down three kings. He shall speak words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High. Now, I believe these saints are the ones that turn to God after the rapture and die for their faith, that don't take the mark of the beast. And for a time, the Antichrist is actually going to rule and kill a lot of those people. And he shall think to change the times and the laws. The Antichrist will oppose God's law so much that he will actually go forth and change laws and make it a law to worship him. Some people think like the Revolutionary War, when they actually changed the calendar law from 7 days to 10 days. So that way even the calendar wouldn't even glorify God in a 7-day creation. We don't know. But we do know that he's going to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and a half a time. Now we know through scripture, a time is a year, times are 2 years, and a half a time is 3.5 years, half a year. So you add that up and you get 3.5 years. But the court shall sit in judgment, and his dominion shall be taken away to be consumed and destroyed till the end. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kings under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. His kingdom shall be an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion shall serve and obey. We see that in the end, he's going to rise up, but God will oppose him and win. Now, Revelation 13, 5 through 7. Let me read this to you because it's still the same language and it gives us interpretation. And the beast, verse 5, was given a mouth uttering haughty and blaspheming words. This beast was haughty and blaspheming words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. 42 months is 3.5 years. It opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. And it was allowed to make war over the saints to conquer them. Again, those who take the mark of the beast that time that are being persecuted and killed. And authority was given it over every tribe and people and language and nation, and all who dwelt on earth will worship it. Speaking of the Antichrist, everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb who is slain. People are actually going to follow the Antichrist. Someone claiming to be God, that brings peace, that has signs and wonders, but God is in control. And he actually allows this to happen. And guess what? He's in control, and he's over every earthly kingdom and every demonic force. Daniel 2, you remember the statue, there was all these pyres and these things going on, empires and those stuff going, and out of nothing made by man, out of the mountain, a rock, a stone appeared, and it crushed the entire statue. Remember that? Daniel chapter 2, verse 45, a stone was cut from the mountain by no human hand, and that it broke at pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, the gold. All these kingdoms were crushed by this stone, which we recognize as Jesus, the Messiah. And as Daniel is seeing this and hearing this stuff, we see the greatest dominion, God's kingdom. In verses 9 through 18, it says, as I looked, Daniel was trying to interpret this stuff. He's seeing all this stuff going on. And as I looked, thrones were placed. And the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and his hair, his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, and its wheels were burning fire. A stream fired issued and came out from before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were open. Now, clearly, this vision that God, now Daniel is having, is God's greatness, the Ancient of Days that we know as God. And it speaks of God's wisdom. It speaks how he knows and he's seen. Nothing surprises God. He's the Ancient of Days. He's been from the beginning and he will be till the end. And so he sees kingdoms come and go. And he's wise enough to judge those kingdoms, those empires, those people that do wrong. It says that his clothing is white as snow, signifying his righteousness, his purity, that he's holy. But his hair is white as well, signifying his wisdom, that he could judge everyone in all wisdom. And what is this Ancient of Days doing while all this stuff's happening? Sitting down, hanging out, He's on his throne. I mean, he's not stressed. He's not, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is so, I didn't know. He's actually orchestrating from the winds of heaven, doing this. It's not stressing God out because he knows he will appropriate judgment on every single thing, on all evil. He will make every wrong right. And this is significant because his throne is a fiery throne. Fire, judgment. And it goes everywhere to everyone because its wheels were burning with fire. Meaning that the thrones on the fire, which signifies his supernatural power, and the wheels express the power, they can go anywhere. He's able to rule and reign with his power. And it says in this text, the court sat in judgment and the books were open. He was going to rule and reign, make every wrong right. And notice one last thing, the multitude were before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The idea is this: everyone will know God's power at the end and his righteous judgment. No one can hide from God. No one can hide from him. He demands the attention of everyone, and the multitudes upon 10,000 times 10,000 will worship him. And you could read that in Revelation 4 and 5. Even in verse 13 of chapter 5, I heard every creature in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and the sea, and all that is in them, saying to them, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing, honor, and glory and might forever and ever. It's sort of cool when you put all this stuff in. I know I'm talking for a long time, but there are so many more verses about this. And then Daniel, in verse 11, he says, this is beautiful. I love this. As I looked, because of the sound of the great works of the horn was speaking. These pompous words. The Antichrist now is speaking. He's like, his focus is on God. The Antichrist is speaking. So he takes attention off of God, Ancient of Days. He looks at this beast. And it says, as I looked, the beast was killed. Just done. Isn't that interesting how the enemy tries to get you off of God? And God's going to say, no, it's all about me. And its body destroyed and was given over to be burned with fire. As for the rest of the beasts, their dominion were taken away, but their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. Revelation 19:20 says that the beast was captured and that they were thrown into the lake of fire. The Antichrist and these other kingdoms seem so great, right? With pompous words, with big talk and wisdom, until you compare things to God. The whole world was going to follow the Antichrist. And everyone's going to be looking to him until God comes in the scene. And what's going to end up happening is God's going to say one word and he's over. It's done. And so many times the enemy wants to get our attention with so much stuff and all this wisdom. And that compares and fails to anything about God's kingdom and what he has to say in his living word. One commentator said, the overall picture is simple, that whatever opposes the Ancient of Days is ultimately destroyed. King and kingdoms may rise and fall, but God remains on his throne and rules over all with wisdom, righteousness, and power. Now, this is great news, isn't it? Think about it. Every wrong will be made right. Anyone that opposes God, how many times have we been looking at through this section of living for God, that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble? Amazing. But let me just give you a little slant here. Everyone that opposes God will be humbled. He will make every wrong right. And we see in this section God's power. But we also see God's love. Because I'm not calling you all Antichrist. But guess what? I know that all of you have opposed God at one point or another in your life. Because the Bible says that we have sinned, which is a revolt against who God is. And so if he makes every wrong right, and even we oppose him, then we will have judgment on ourselves. But God is not just God that is great. He is a God of love. And in his wisdom, he has taken that judgment off of mankind because he bared that judgment on himself. This God, Ancient of Days, actually entered into our world. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but the gift of God is eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. You read Philippians 2, 6 and 7, 6 through 11, how Jesus, being form of God, became man, all God, all man, humbled himself, gave up his own blood to take the wrath of mankind. In Revelation 5, John sees the vision And he starts weeping because there's these scrolls and there's no one to open these scrolls and seals, and there's no one that can be perfect and be with God. And he says, well, who's gonna live a perfect life? Who can do this for me? Well, I don't. And he just weeps. And in Revelation chapter 5, verse 10, it says that there was one like a lamb that went and opened the scrolls and died. Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seat, for you were slain, and by your blood you were ransomed people for God, for every tribe and language and people on the nation, and you have made a kingdom and its priest to our God, and they shall reign on earth. And now Daniel is seeing this great judgment, this great power and God's power, but he's also seeing his goodness, because look at verse 13. I saw in the night visions, behold, the clouds of heaven. There came one like a son of man, and he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory, a kingdom that all peoples and nations and languages should serve him. His dominion was an everlasting kingdom, which shall never not pass away, and his kingdom one shall not be destroyed. As for me, Daniel, my spirit within me was anxious, and visions in my head alarmed me. I approached one who stood there and asked what the truth concerning all this. So he told me and made known to me the interpretation of these things. These four beasts, well, they are the four kings that shall arise of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, forever, and forever. Daniel sees clouds of heaven. There came one like a son of man. Has that phrase ring a bell to you? This was Jesus' most popular name for himself, the Son of Man. It's said 81 times in the Gospels, 41 times alone in Matthew, speaking of a prophetic Messiah, and Jesus said, I am the Son of Man. Matthew 24:30, they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great might. After Jesus died and rose again, he ascended unto the heaven to the right hand of the Father, able to open the scrolls. And the disciples were looking and like, Jesus, where'd you go? And two angels came and they said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who is taken up from you in heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. He's going to come back, rule and reign, and going to come through the clouds. This Son of Man, the clouds tell us that although the Son of Man is human likeness, he also is heavenly origin. He is like us and he is like God. Jesus is fully God and fully man. And the Ancient of Days in his wisdom promised that we would have a Messiah. When he established Israel, David the king, in 2 Samuel 7, 12 and 11, it says, your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established. Now, why is this promise so important? Because Daniel is a part of Israel. And where he's at when he's getting this vision, this empire made him a eunuch. They took away his family. It just stunk, and it was awful. And in all of their minds, they're thinking, is God really in control? Is he really going to come through? And the sad thing is, Israel had no one to blame but themselves. Because the reason why they were captive is because they sinned. So God judged them. But just like God would make a way for Israel to stand and stay faithful to that promise, he tells us we've all sinned. We're in captivity of sin, and we can't blame anyone but ourselves because there's a trespass and we just break the law. But I've made a way because I'm not only wise and powerful, I'm loving. And so I'll take on that. I'll become the Son of Man. I will do that work. And verse 17 and 18, these beasts, they oppose God who judged. But the saints received God's kingdom. The same rock, the Son of Man that crushes the statue will actually be a refuge for those that humble themselves and live by faith through grace, having Jesus their king now. And so the question, after I know this is a long Bible study, I know I talk long and this is even longer, right? But the reality is, are you living for God's kingdom? Are you living for another kingdom? Because kingdoms come and go. Demonic forces come and go. many kingdoms of man, they just live for themselves. But the Bible says that God's kingdom will be established for all eternity forever. And Jesus challenges us and tells us to follow him and allow him to be king right now. John 12, 26, if anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Christians will be with Jesus forever. Because where Jesus will be, we will be. And the same rock that crushed all the statues, you know what? The people of the Most High are right there with Jesus as well. And we could choose now to allow Jesus to be our king. And so Daniel received these visions. In verse 28, he was greatly alarmed. Here's the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts were greatly alarmed and my color changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. I understand studying end times could be hard. These prophecies, these things, there's so many verses and it's a long, Bible study today. And we could be so caught up in details and worried and stressed, but do you know what Daniel did? He kept these matters to his heart. Let's remember that Jesus wins. Because he already did. On the cross of Christ, where everyone agrees, sin was trampled, death was conquered. And he says, when we gather together to remember that, remember the verse about communion, to take communion? It's actually to do that, to proclaim until he comes back again. That he actually is not just a powerful God and that he does judge, but there he's a loving God and that he serves his people. Revelation 1, 5, and 6, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be the glory, the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Jesus, we thank you so much that we can study these things. Lord, we thank you so much, God, that we can gather under your name. And we do, Lord, want to just say yes and amen. Lord, we're responding to the love you have for us. I know some of this could be complicated and hard and even troubling to think about. There's going to be a time where you're going to judge everyone. That Lord, heaven is real, but also hell is real and judgment is real. Lord, may we understand that you're a God of wisdom and love, and that you've made a way. And may we live for you, believing that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Lord, I pray for those that don't have a relationship with you, that they would turn from their sin and turn to you, knowing that they cannot oppose you, but that you give grace to the humble. And so we thank you for this time, Lord. We know it's a little bit different format. We had to cut a video. We're doing longer this week and less worship and all these different things. But like I said in the beginning, as we study this stuff, and as this is the hard study because it's laying a foundation of things, I just pray, God, that our eyes would be on you, Jesus, that we would walk away from this study knowing that you are a God that saves, a God that loves, and that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. May you be glorified in our hearts, in our lives. May you be glorified, and may we continue to study your word to refine our faith, to build us up and be encouraged for the days that we live in. May we take these things to our heart and live for you, Lord. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen.